Welcome back to the Sixth Gear Garage. Today, I'm going to show how to remove and install a radiator in a 1996 to 2004 Mustang. This is my 1997 Mustang GT. I've had so many other projects on this channel that it hasn't really been featured much. Well, all that's about to change, starting with installing a Mishimoto radiator. This car only has 80,000 miles, and today I'm going to install its fourth radiator. The first two were leaking at the plastic intakes. So for the third radiator, I spent around $200 on a solid aluminum one without the plastic ends. Just a few years later, once again, it's slowly leaking. I did some research and found this is a known problem for the SN95 Mustang due to the front end flexing from torque. And that's what causes them to crack and leak over time. So this time, I'm installing a Mishimoto radiator. It's all aluminum, but with a patented mounting design that absorbs the stress from the front end flexing. Mishimoto didn't sponsor this video or give me any discount. I pay for this radiator because I'm tired of replacing them every few years, and the Mishimoto has a lifetime warranty. So I'll be giving you my honest opinion on it. So here's the all-aluminum aftermarket radiator that I installed a few years back. It's a no-name eBay brand, and it's a lot thicker than the OEM replacements with plastic ends. But it didn't last. First thing to do is start draining the radiator. I'm getting the car up on jack stands so I can fit a bucket underneath. The petcock is on the lower passenger side. Loosen it and have a bucket ready. I don't take it all the way out because it'll gush everywhere and make a mess on the floor. I'll let this drain slowly while I take the hoses and fan off. Vice grips work great on loosening these OEM clamps. Then a big flathead screwdriver to help slide the hose off. Here's the plug for the low coolant level sensor. These three 10mm bolts hold on the plastic tank. This hose clamp is kind of in a tight spot. Rather than mess with it, I'm just going to leave the hose connected and I'll have enough room to move the tank out of the way. Next, unplug this sensor. And I'm using this popper tool to pop off the plastic clips that hold the harness to the fan. Now for the upper radiator hose. Vice grips working great again here. There's an 8mm bolt holding on the passenger side of the fan. And another 8mm bolt on the driver's side next to the battery tray. This plastic cover is in the way of the top clamps that hold the radiator in place. There are four plastic push screws holding it on. Once the plastic screw is out, the push clip comes right out. And it's normal for these to break with age. Now I'm loosening the bolt holding the passenger side radiator clamp. And the same on the driver's side clamp. Then they lift right off. I'm using a bungee strap here to keep the plastic tank out of the way for now. I'm going to remove the fan and set it aside on the engine. It's in there pretty tight with this thick aftermarket radiator. The fan comes out easier with the OEM radiator. No need to unplug everything. There's enough slack in the wire to set it here out of the way. And there's so much more room for activities. Now I have room to reach the lower hose clamp. Depending on how the clamp is rotated, you may be able to reach it from underneath the car. My clamp was rotated to the side, so this was the easiest way to get to it. Plus, I don't have a lift, so I'd rather work over the car than under it. These OEM clamps are stiff. With the clamp out of the way, I can slide the lower hose off of the radiator, or radiator if you're in Pennsylvania. Now it's time to remove the old radiator. Again, this is a tight fit because it's twice as thick as the OEM one. I'm fighting with it here a little bit. It's hard to tell, but it was actually leaking here, where these passages join the end caps, on both sides. Perfect timing! UPS just dropped off the new Mishimoto radiator. I want this to be the fourth and final radiator for this car. It was about $340, but with the lifetime warranty, it's worth it. It even comes with an air freshener. We've got some hardware. These must be the mounting brackets. Very nice, heavy duty, powder coated steel. They really packaged this well too. I've had other radiators arrive pretty banged up before, and that's frustrating. Here it is. Let's have a look at this beauty. No. All right, I can't believe this happened. I just have bad luck when it comes to radiators. I mean, this thing was surrounded by foam in a huge box. I don't see how in the world this could happen. Oh, I didn't see that. Look at that rip and crease in the box. I'd say UPS dropped it on that corner from a pretty good height. Well, let's see the rest of it. I really don't have time to send this back and wait for another one. So, today we learned to make sure your new radiator is in hand, undamaged, before you remove your old one. The rest of the radiator looks fine, so I'm going to attempt to fix this with a blowtorch and some sockets. It has a warranty, so I might as well try, right? Well, that worked! It took a few minutes, so I'll upload that repair in a separate video to help keep this one short. We have some hardware here. First, I'll make sure the drain plug is tight. These rubber grommets go in the mounting holes. They must help absorb the vibrations. Put this here, and this here. And a washer, and a bolt. I'll hand tighten everything first. Then, tighten it down with a ratchet. And the same thing on the other side. See where the old mounting points were attached to the corners of the radiator? Well, these are on the steel brackets, which have some flex to them. Now, that front end flex from the torque isn't going to be twisting the radiator anymore. Before installing a new radiator, it's a good idea to flush it out first, just in case there's any dirt or contaminants inside. Lay it down flat so the entire thing fills up with water. Now it's time. So this thing fits pretty tight. I'm trying to be gentle, but it's taking some elbow grease to get it in. Once I'm sure the two lower mounting pegs are sitting in the rubber isolators, I can put the lower hose back on. Here's the problem. The top bolt of the passenger side bracket is hitting this metal bracket for the AC lines. That's pushing the radiator over too far. I'm just prying that bracket over a little to make more room. That helped. Now the top mount fits better, although it's still pretty tight. If you have a 1996 GT or Cobra and you're wondering why so many radiators are listed for fitting 97 to 04, that's because 96s came with a slightly smaller radiator. The 96 radiator's driver's side upper mount is triangular and located a few inches from the tank. I read there were problems with 96s running hot, and Ford put out a TSB, which involved moving the mounts out and fitting the 4-inch wider 97 radiator in them, along with the AC condenser, brackets, and fan. I read they even did away with a honeycomb grill for better cooling. I'll put a link in the description for more info on that. Now I'm getting the driver's side in place, and it seems tight too. This car has never been in an accident, so I'm kind of surprised this doesn't fit a little better. I'm tightening the passenger side mount and the driver's side. The last thing to do before the fan goes in is slide the lower hose clamp back on the radiator. Next, gently work the fan back in, being sure not to scrape any of the fins on the new radiator. Then, tighten the bolt on the passenger side of the fan. And the same on the driver's side. Pop in all the plastic clips on the fan for the wiring harness. And plug everything back in. I can put the tank back now. There are two bolts in front and one in the back. One more issue. This metal AC line is in the way of the hose. It moved in the way even more when I bent that metal bracket over to make room for the radiator. So I'm carefully bending it back a little bit by hand to make room for the hose. That worked. Slide the upper hose clamp on, and that looks good. Time to reinstall the plastic cover. The outer push pins go on first. Then push the plastic screw in the middle to tighten them up. Now I'm installing the small hose from the tank to the radiator. And don't forget to plug in that coolant temp level sensor. And done! Well, with the mechanical part anyways, now I need to fill and bleed the system. I'm using unmixed coolant, so I'll have to add one part coolant and then one part water. Or you can buy 50-50 pre-mixed coolant and not have to worry about mixing it yourself. Unlike radiators that have a fill cap, this plastic tank is the only way to fill the radiator on these cars. When it reads full, it's time to start the car. The engine needs to warm up so that the thermostat opens and cycles the coolant through the cooling system. That's going to bring any air bubbles to the top. Give it a little RPM to help it warm up faster. There's the thermostat housing. When it opens up, this hose will get hot. Then the hose will be carrying hot coolant from the engine to the radiator.
It's getting warmer.
Here's some steam from some coolant I spilled on the radiator when I was reconnecting this hose. The hose is getting a little warm. Here you can see the coolant level has dropped. That's because coolant is replacing air trapped in the system as it cycles through. When the level drops, just keep topping it off. Also, it's a good idea to check under the car to be sure there are no leaks. All right, now the hose is starting to get hot. Let's go inside and check the temperature. Still not warm enough. Oh, I have a check engine light. The code came up because the temperature of the fuel and coolant were too far apart, probably due to air in certain areas of the cooling system when I first started. I cleared the code with a scanner and it didn't come back on. Here you can see air bubbles are still creeping up. One way to speed this up is to increase the RPMs. Look at all those bubbles! I gave it some RPMs while watching the temp gauge, and this is about where it gets to when I'm sitting in traffic on a hot day. I hear the fan running, so I know the thermostat is fully open by now. Okay, the hose is too hot to touch now, and the fan is kicked on. Those are good signs that the coolant has been fully cycled through the system. Look how much more coolant it took in. Time to top it off. It's been a while since that last top off, and the temps are steady right now, about in the middle of normal. I'm confident all of the air is out of the system. I'll still check the level the next couple of times I drive it just to be sure. Thank you all for watching. Please like and subscribe if you found this helpful. It really helps the channel grow. You'll be seeing this car again, along with many other projects, here at the 6th Gear Garage.